get started. Maybe some people will continue to trickle in. Does this work? Maybe not. Oh, there it goes. All right. Good morning, everyone. I'm Rudy Schubert from the IEEE, and this session is a little bit different from many of the other ones because this is interactive. So I think you're told this sort of coming in when you're picking up clickers and signing in. What we're trying to do is have this interactive workshop that's really looking at a technology roadmap for smart glasses. Ori Inbar had approached a number of us maybe a couple months ago about trying to pull this session together with a long-term goal of considering putting a white paper together looking at technology roadmap. And as a part of that, we thought, well, we'll do this interactive workshop, use it as a way for people to provide input back to us. So as we get started, I was just going to put up a few. Well, I'm going to try to explain how we're going to do this today. You're probably confused by the clickers that Josh is handing out on the way in, and he's going to give a more in-depth explanation of that. But again, the goals of this workshop is, we'd really like to see, for lack of a better term, we're going to use smart glasses, but this is really the range of different types of devices that you've seen down in the show floor. We'd really like to see them proliferate, have it become more a mass adoption situation where people, really want to have these things. So what, considering where we are today and where people would like things to go, what are the opportunities that are out there? What are some of the barriers, both technology-wise, market-wise? What are the things that need to happen to get to this mass proliferation of smart glass-type devices? We're going to talk a little bit about use cases. I'll introduce our team in a few minutes, but Peter from our team is going to talk a little bit on use cases and devices a bit. And so if you think about these barriers and opportunities relative to use cases, try to look at where the intersection is on all those issues. And as I mentioned, this is really, the goal is for this not to be a once and done session. We're going to have a lot of discussion today. And very often you go to an event and people talk about it and then they go away and next year they talk about it again and you really haven't made any progress. What we're aiming to do is to put together somewhat of an ongoing working group that might meet via teleconference every week, every 2 weeks, whatever the group feels is best suited to what it wants to do, towards collecting all this information, getting further input, putting a paper together, having that done by the end of the year. And if there are different aspects where people say this is something that really needs to be worked on, we need the AR VR community to be working on this, we can actually try to set up some action plans and groups that can actually pursue those things that need to get done. So how we're going to do this session, I'm going to start off talking just a little bit about the logistics of what we're trying to do today. And you'll see this icebreaker organization. What we're going to actually do is we're going to break you into four different groups. I'll explain that again in a bit, in just a few minutes. The groups are going to be broken down more or less by market type, or different ways that devices are actually used. And Peter's going to, again, talk a little bit about definition and taxonomy. What's the scope? When we started talking about this workshop, one of the issues we said is there's so many different issues to consider when it comes to smart glasses. How do we bound this? And so, it's really just how we're scoping this entire discussion because you can't necessarily cover everything. We'll break into the four groups that we'll explain. I'll have that up in a second. And those four groups will spend somewhere between 45 minutes and an hour first doing some brainstorming about opportunities and issues that need to be addressed, then looking at the priorities, and then you're each going to elect a spokesperson from that group to come up and just do a five-minute overview of what your views were from amongst the group. And then once those groups give those five-minute readouts, we're just going to come back again and open that up to group discussion. Somebody could, from one group might say, I totally disagree with what group two found, or vice versa, or you might find concurrence. So, we don't want to necessarily restrict the conversations to those individual groups. We're going to try to bring that up to the full group for further discussion as well. And then, finally, summary and next steps. Where are we going to go from there? I have this optional follow-on discussion. This is a little fuzzy to me. Ori had actually said that if we wanted to continue, we have a room to continue this in the afternoon. We'll see where we're at the end of the session and see if anybody wants to come back and talk about it more in the afternoon. There's so many other things to do. I can understand if you don't want to do that. So this is just a quick vision statement. I won't read it. You can actually look at it. Again, the idea was to put together a white paper. And the thought was, all right, if you're going to put together a white paper on this, what are you actually trying to accomplish in the white paper? So this was a vision statement. Was it Peter or Ron? One of you put that one together. Was that Ron?
Partly.
Okay. Actually, before I even go farther, let me just introduce the core team. So we were working with Ori Inbar when we got started, but really four of us have been primarily talking every week and trying to figure out how to pull this together. I'll start with Peter. Peter Restraten is up here in the front. You'll be hearing from him in a minute. Then Ron is going to be coming up. And we're also going to be facilitating these groups. We're not sending you off on your own to say, all right, what do we do now? We're going to act as facilitators for each of these groups. And Josh in the back, you probably many of you met on the way in. Josh is the keeper of the clickers, which he's going to come up and explain in just a minute. So, again, what is a roadmap? Just very high level of trying to identify what people's collective vision is on, where are the needs, the opportunities when it comes to smart glasses in this case. But this is really for a roadmap in general. Looking at where we are now, where we want to get to be in a longer-term situation. And it's really just a high-level view that is going to help us set a path for projects that need to get done to accomplish these goals. All right, some of the ground rules for the session, once we get out into the individual breakout groups. Again, they're really meant to be brainstorming type of ideas. There were some folks that we did some outreach to early on just to get some input. Kind of some ringers in the groups that might facilitate the discussions a bit more. An important thing is this is an idea gathering exercise that we're doing. So if somebody comes out with something that you think is just a ludicrous idea, somebody says all smart glasses must be green. And the idea is you put it down on paper, it's what somebody suggested, all ideas are welcome, and whether you think they're crazy or not, that gets hashed out in the prioritization of whether this is truly something that's important or not important. So again, the subgroups prioritize the ideas. And one of the things we've been trying to do too, and you'll see this when we get to the market segment, we're trying to get sort of a cross-section. So we don't want to necessarily have just device manufacturers. We really want to have people who represent different markets, different devices, use case situations, really just trying not to have this driven necessarily by one segment of the industry. And all this data we're going to use, we're going to put this together in a summary, and we're going to try to write all this stuff up as a first draft, and that'll be the basis where this working group will take off and go from. All right, so the breakout groups that we're going to do. This was a bit of a struggle for the group. It's like, again, so many different ways we could go. We broke it into four market-based groups. And those four market-based groups are each going to be addressing very similar questions. So the questions are somewhat cross-cutting across markets, but markets was just a better way to go. So we have industrial applications. Peter's going to handle that one. Ron is going to do consumer applications. This is Ron again. All right. Josh is going to do military emergency services type applications. And then we have professional services applications. That's kind of everything else that where you might see devices being used. And I'll be floating a bit as a facilitator, but Lloyd Green up here in the front is going to be working with me on that group as well. Oop. Actually, Josh, where does your slides come in here? After Peter's? Oh, all right. So we're going to switch off. I'm going to hand off to Josh. He's going to explain a bit of logistics. You came in, you got these clickers, and you're thinking, what am I going to do with these? This is actually an interesting way to collect some information early on. So. Or you have the other one. Okay.
Okay, so some of who does not have a clicker yet and wants to stay and help do this? Okay, go over to Ron, and he'll write your name down, issue you a clicker. If you don't want to stay and contribute to the workshop, that's fine, because there's a lot of other cool things going on. But what we're going to be doing with these clickers is taking data that we're going to help as input into the subgroups. So we're going to ask some sort of initial questions that sort of give us an idea of who you are and what your interests are and your involvement in the augmented reality community. And then We're going to, after we learn about more about the taxonomy of smart glasses, we're going to ask you which type you think is most significant or most important in the market segment that you represent. So these are just, there's an on button on these clickers. When we tell you, you'll turn that on, and then we'll be able to see up on the screen here the answers. It's like, you know, if you're in a college class and you had an audience response system, that's what this is. So, but we also can collect a lot of data this way, so that's why we're doing this. So once you've all gotten your clickers, we'll switch over to my laptop and we'll start getting some information about who you are.
That's really what it amounted to. Yeah. Probably should start.
All right, can we switch to this laptop now? All right. So the first question, let me get this started here. The first question is, how many times have you attended AWE? This is just to sort of, should be an easy one to answer. Does everybody know how to work the clickers? Any questions about how to work them, how to turn them on? Once you've answered, it should put a little check mark by your name, or by the answer there. Okay. Yes, you just click another answer and it'll redo your answer. And then so we can see how many answers there are here, the time for the question. And so once I'm ready to stop, I'll press stop here, and that will end the answers for that question. And then we'll go to the next one. And some of you are still getting your clickers, so just join in once you're ready. Yeah, so for that question, that's closed. Now another question is open. My role in AR can be most closely described as what? Software developer, hardware developer, user, entrepreneur, investor. No, you don't need to send. If you press the button, it will register that answer. Any other questions about how this works? All right. No investors here, darn it. Just kidding. All right. Okay, so we're going to close that one. Now we're going to go to the next one. My AR work happens mostly in, this is sort of just to get an idea of where you're from and what area. There may be differences in markets in various countries, so that's why we're thinking that. All right. And then this answer will influence the group that you're in. So pick the type of market that most closely represents your primary focus for AR. We may do some shifting around if we need to. Right. Has everyone had a chance to answer that one? It looks like 29 responses. All right. Okay. What's your area?
I'm a journalist, but I'm very
interested. Okay.
Yeah, I left E blank. I knew there would be another. There always is. So, all right. So we have We have 12 in industrial, 4 in professional, 4 in military, and 8 in consumer.
That's actually not too bad of
not
a breakdown.
Bad. Yeah. So
I guess I would suggest that our E join one of our middle two lower groups, just but you're not constrained to it. We were hoping to get at least 4 or 5, you know, minimum in each group, so I think we're not too bad there.
All right, so that is that for these initial questions. I think we need to switch back to the other slides now.
Or are they on yours too?
I don't have
them.
Oh,
no, that's right, yeah. We got to switch back. You're right. Okay. All right, so that at least gives us a little basic demographics to work with as we start collecting information. Peter's going to come up now. What? This is you. Is it not in the right order?
No, I think it's not the slide that I use.
Peter, do you need a mic?
Yeah.
There we
go. Okay. The aim of the game is a roadmap. There are many ways to formulate a roadmap, but the roadmap for the industry says in the years to come what needs to happen on different aspects before the market really breaks open. And okay, these are just a couple of things that if you're familiar with smart eyewear will ring a bell. We all know the Google Glass, for example, and the heating of the processor. At least if you worked with it a couple of times, you will have been facing that. So the processor capacity, does it need to improve? What needs to happen? The display, the sensors, the way we interact with it, and maybe many other things will need to progress over time in order to land or to break open the market. And when I talk about market, yeah, the professional services is another ball game compared to chemical industry or compared to the consumer. So in order to structure it a little bit, and in order to make sure that we don't start this discussion with a Babylonic confusion, we should get on the same page of what do you mean with smart eyewear? Is a Google Glass the same as an Osterhout or as Netir, just to name a few that are downstairs? Do they classify? Now you can classify hardware or technology in many different ways. So one way to implement or to propose a taxonomy is technology, display technology, for example. But as we start from the ambition to formulate a roadmap for the industry, meaning landing, market breaking open, there is no better way than to formulate or look at the thing from the one that is putting the device on his face, from the wearer's perspective. So that's why we propose a taxonomy, but it's a taxonomy, and for sure it's debatable. But at least if we use these definitions for today, we more or less exclude major confusions, we more or less get on the same page, and at least we'll have a meaningful discussion. So, from the wearer's perspective, what is on my face? The first class of devices that we call is the smart rear mirror. It's like the rear view mirror in your car. You're driving for 60 minutes, and my question is, how many seconds did you look in your rear view mirror? If you're telling me 10 minutes, my guess is you had a lot of accidents in that 1 hour. Your eyes are in front of you. You only look in that mirror when you need to look in it, when you're making a maneuver. That's it. So that's the first type of wearable devices. Just for the record, not all devices are on this. It's not the full list. It's just a couple of names, and I will give some other names because it will ring a bell. If you walk downstairs, you tried some of these devices, you will recognize them. But the Google Glass, the Vuzix, the GoldenEye is not here. The Regen Jet, it's the cycling glass. It's all rear view mirrors in the top right corner of the eye, in the bottom of the right eye or the left eye. It's a little display with a lot of other stuff in your face, in your field of view. And is this augmented reality? We'd rather call it informed reality, because your eyes are on the real world, and once in a while, like the rear view mirror, you get information. Information that helps you, protects you, whatever. So, typical things like, okay, hands-free instructions, just one example. Then you have the smart monocular. The smart monocular is a different thing. It's also a device on your face with one display, like the previous category, but this time it's really in front of your iris. You have to watch through it, unless you remove it, but the purpose is it's in front of your eyes, you're looking through it, and you get the real world, which your eyes are seeing, the one eye better than the other eye, but okay. You're seeing the real world, and then digital information gets projected on top of that, assuming right eye. Okay, we're talking about things like the ORAS from OptInvent that you can see. We're talking about the Lumus. Maybe some of you have been experimenting. You have the see-through from Luster. Is there also in the hall. There is GlassUp. And there is many more. This is really augmented reality, because now you're looking through a screen and there is real image combined with digital information. But you're still looking at the real world, but augmented. And it can as well be used for hands-free to guide you. It's like navigating, take that street. Well, you're seeing the street and you're seeing an arrow, take it. Then you have the smart binocular. The smart binocular is, in many cases, vendors that have a monocular have the binocular. Lumus, to take the example, Luster, I saw it yesterday as well. So it's the same technology, but now not on one eye, it's on two eyes. So both of your eyes are forced, I would say, to look to the optical engine to perceive the world and get on top a layer of digital information. We are talking now about the Moverio, the Epson, which is downstairs, Ethier, which is downstairs, Osterhout, the R6, R7, which you've maybe tested, the Meta Pro, the HoloLens, all these devices considered from the wearer's perspective are a device on your nose, and you have to look with both eyes through it. Of course, what's the advantage of one eye compared to two eyes compared to one eye? A broader field of view. It covers a broader range. It's also augmented reality. It's also an augmented world that you're now focused on. More than the monocular, because one eye is open for the world. In this case, no eye is open for the world as is. It is the augmented world that is absorbed by both of your eyes and can be used to act in that augmented world or to play in that augmented world. And then you go to immersive eyewear. Immersive eyewear is like the diving mask on your nose, the ones that have played around with the Oculus Rift. There is no reality in your eyes any longer. There is only a digital world. A world that that's completely imaginary or fake or whatever you like to call it, but it is a world that your eyes believe to see but which is not there. And that can be perfect to play a game. And then the last category that we call from a wearer's perspective is the glass cam. It's a kind of a weird category. It is what I would call, it's a GoPro embedded in a pair of glasses. There is no display in those glasses. You just put them on, there's the example of the smart from Pivot Head. It's the GoPro camera there. There is no display. Why? The device is meant to be for somebody to wear it when he's biking in a canyon and then showing off to his friends what a dangerous route he's taking. And you don't want to get a mail when you're close to an edge of a cliff, because that mail could be fatal for you. So there is no display. There is only recording of what your eyes are seeing to stream it to somebody else to educate him or to show off, whatever. So that's the glass camera. So we come down from the one that wears the glasses to this taxonomy. I'm sure there are reasons to give other names or reasons to add maybe other categories, but at least for the rest of the discussion, we could take these definitions and reason upon them. Feel free to comment on it, but when we ask to answer questions, let's use these definitions to avoid confusion. Now, there is one slide that brings them all together. And this slide is on the vertical X, you have the focus or the field of view of reality. The field of view of reality means, what do I see from the real world? There was an interesting session of psychologists yesterday afternoon who were talking about the inattentional blindness. The example was taken about, I ask you to count the number of people and a gorilla walks in the room and half of the people won't see the gorilla. Inattentional blindness. It's related to cognitive loading. So the field of view of reality is 100% with the glass camera, the GoPro embedded in the spectacle, because there is no cognitive load. Your brains just see the world as is, and they need to, or you're just cycling off the cliff. So 100% eyes on the world. The other extreme of the spectrum is the diving mask on your face called the Oculus Rift, and you have zero field of the world. Zero perception, zero awareness of what reality is in front of you. That is the immersed eyewear. Now on the horizontal X, there is the opposite. There is how much brain feed is happening on top of what your eyes are naturally seeing. With the glass camera, there is no brain feed other than what your eyes are seeing, because you don't want to get distracted. The cognitive load must be zero other than what your eyes are seeing. On the other side, Oculus Rift can make you think you're Superman and you're flying, whatever, because it's a 100% feat of the mind by other things than what the eyes would see in terms of reality. And so from the one extreme to the other extreme, you go down the line and you have your eyes on the action. A surgeon with an Oculus Rift would be a very dangerous thing, unless it's for training and education. Then the Oculus Rift would mean training without risk. So eyes on the action, eyes on the augmented world, the world that is the view that is enriched with digital information, or eyes in the virtual world. Comes down to this slide that maps the typologies, the five typologies of smart eyewear on that graph, from the glass camera to the immersive eyewear. And it is no coincidence that all of these devices exist today. There is a monocular, there's the binocular, there is the rear view mirror, there is the Oculus Rift, there is the pivot head, and maybe in the future other glass embedded cameras or camera embedded in a glass, because there is a need for everything. The only question is where, when, and how many people are waiting for it, and can we at this stage say that the technology is ready to deliver and to meet the promises? And that's the debate that kicks off this session of building a roadmap.
Okay. Thanks, Peter. Okay, so now we're going to move to the breakout group section of the of this session. So I'm going to move people around, but first, let's see. I'm going to have Rob. All right, so it's four groups. Probably easier if I put that up there. Again, we're going to do like about a half an hour of data gathering, and then some prioritization, and then the report outs back. But to get you in the right places, I'm going to have Peter go into this corner over here for anyone who, when they did the clicker in the beginning, wants to be in the industrial applications group. I'm going to put Ron in the back corner for the consumer ones. This is Ron, and we'll go back near where the audio board is in the back. We're going to have Josh is going to run the military emergency services, which is going to be the back corner near where you came in. And then the professional services will do this up here. Feel free to pull chairs in a circle. That might be a little bit easier. I know they won't be crazy that we're moving the chairs around, but we'll do that anyway to facilitate the group discussions. And as soon as you all move around, we're going to talk about the questions that you want to be addressing in those groups. But we're going to let you all move first. I think that was just a backup in case Peter wants to do it. So. All right, you want to start over here for now? I'm going to do that. Yep. Hey. Pick a corner. Are you looking for a corner now? Sorry? This is the, well, the professional services group. Yep. Okay. So now that we've got everybody just about in groups, I'll give you a I'll give people just like a 30 seconds just to move their chairs around. Then I'm going to explain a couple of quick things. All right. All right, so up on the screen, we have the brainstorming questions that we came up with. You know, again, with limited time, we can only cover so many different things. But each of your facilitators essentially know, you know, where we're trying to go. One of the most important things right from the start, we need you to pick a scribe, somebody to take some notes on this so that each of the groups can report out easily. You know, like in the case of like, you know, Peter and Josh and Ron, they're trying to facilitate the group discussion around the questions, but it's hard for them to facilitate the discussion and write everything down at the same time. So, you know, we would ask that somebody volunteer from each group to be the scribe. And I think, do you each have paper in each of the groups? Okay. Yeah. Well, we apologize, we wanted to get easels and markers, but for some reason that didn't work out, so we've gone to paper and pen for the most part. All right, so there's a few different questions. What you should be doing is spending like no more than, you know, 5-10 minutes tops on any of these three question areas for the brainstorming part. So the first one, and actually maybe Peter, you actually crystallized these down, maybe you could add to it too, but we're he can, Peter will give a little color, but it's the buying criteria, you know, top five use cases. When it comes to use cases, obstacles and challenges, and then what do we need to overcome the hurdles? I don't know if you want to add to that, too.
First question.
Oh, it might not be on.
First question, are we going to go through the slides of Josh on the buying criteria first or at the end? Josh,
where's Josh?
Okay, Josh. Are we going? Yeah, maybe that's the best to start, or not?
Sure.
Yeah, is that?
If you guys want to do it that way, that's fine too.
Because that is input for the second for
okay,
these
well
questions.
We can do that real quick. Can we switch to the podium thing? The podium display?
The use cases. I'll explain in the meantime. The use cases is a kind of definition description of generic use cases. And we will ask your advice. He's going to explain immediately. whether it's important or not. And then that will be a kind of a guide or a context in which we can answer the other questions like buying criteria and so on.
Okay, so this first one, use case rating, there's going to be 14 use cases. We'll just power through these really quickly. You just need to select on your clicker how important you think that use case is in your market segment. So the first one is work order transaction execution. So there's an explanation for each one of these. Just go ahead and read those. For example, this one says, provide information about what the wearer has to do and receives corresponding feedback. For example, work orders, repair orders, quality control tasks. Is this very important, important, neither important nor unimportant, unimportant or very unimportant? Okay. So once I get about 30 of these answers, I'll stop it and we'll move on to the next one. All right, next question. Second screen-based guidance information. And you can see here, this is number two, so when we're in the middle of this, you won't wonder how many questions are left. I'm going to give you 30 seconds to answer this, and then I'm just going to go on to the next one. All right. Next one, AR-based guidance information. This is things like route navigation, procedures, how-to instructions, wire cable plans, product information. This is different than the previous one in the sense that it's overlaid on your field of view versus sort of appended to your field of view.
Are you hiding the results?
Not on purpose, just we will share, this stuff will be, we'll let you see all this stuff. If you want to see it now, that's fine too. Okay. Second screen-based guidance information. Similar to the last one, but oh wait, I might have pressed the wrong button here. Let's see. Oh yeah, I went back. I'm sorry. Let's start that over again. Okay, AR-based training. VR-based training. All right, we're getting faster at answering those. That's good. Guidance by remote expert. All right, AR-based fitting. So you can see digital objects or virtual objects in the real world. Sort of see how they fit. Activity recording. Recording, streaming the action of the wearer from the wearer's perspective. This is question 8 of 14, so we're almost done. AR-based communication. AR-based gaming. VR-based gaming. Augmented media and entertainment. The bionic eye. That sounds cool, doesn't it? I don't mean to sway your opinion of whether that's important or unimportant. Hands-free smartphone. Now there's one final question. Recalling Peter's typology for various types of displays, please see which type. Please answer which typology you think has the most potential in your market. Okay, those are the questions.
Okay.
Yeah, if you can switch to the other slide deck now with the three questions. Okay, so everybody in his market segment has been looking at those use cases and making an opinion about, no, that's not a case in my market segment, or yes, that's the primary issue in or challenge in my market segment. Now, when you start the discussion within your market segment, pick back those use cases in mind that you say these are important, and then answer the questions. Okay, given the fact that, for example, it would help me to execute instructions or do other things or game or whatever, what would be the buying criteria, the top five buying criteria that most of the users, most of the buyers in my market segment would apply to make a choice? Is it technology? Is it field of view? Is it the price? Is it the weight? Is it the fashion aspect? Whatever. Just the five ranking than from high to low buying criteria that you expect that people will apply in your market segment. And then the top use cases, okay, we had those general use cases. Pick the one that you would say these are the top ones in my market segment, and then think about what are the obstacles? Why aren't we using it? Why can't we use it today? Is it not available? Is it just not meeting our requirements? And which things need to happen, that's the third question, to overcome these hurdles? Okay, they need to come up with another device in terms of a display. They need to come up with another way of interacting with the tool. Whatever. The top 3 to 5 maximum things that need to happen to overcome the second question. And that should give us a direction for each market segment in what the roadmap needs to take care of and whether it's realistic or not and on what time frame we can expect it and so on. But that will happen after this session.
Okay.
Any questions? You have the PowerPoint, the sheet.
I do have the Excel spreadsheet.
The Excel spreadsheet, yeah. We can put that on.
And I'll add, too, that once the group start discussing things, I'm going to keep an eye on the time. We are running a little bit over time so far. So we're going to try to do, like, about 7 minutes. We're going to do 10, but we'll do about, like, 7 minutes on each of the 3 main topics up there. So I'll just basically say, time, move to the next question, and then we just move on. So try to keep us on track. Oh, we'll just, yes, sorry. All right, well, Josh gets that up on the screen. Why don't we start the first question right here.
So the
first question is buying criteria.
Can you switch to the podium now?
I'm going to just check your group in.
Yeah.
To this, we're going to move to the second question now. So, I mean, if you need a minute to wrap up, but I've started the clock on question number two at this point. On you. Well, I'm just telling you where we're at the clock, so we should be into the second one, but. All right, we should be starting to move towards that third and final question right now. We are going to have a little extra time at the end to try to pull a summary of each group's findings together. But start moving to the third one if you can. All right, we have, I'm hoping that most people are getting close to being through their third question. I'm going to give another 7 minutes to start summarizing things. So when we reach the top of the hour, all the groups should have finished their discussions, have a decent summary ready to go, and know who's going to actually speak to it. So about 6-7 minutes. Okay, let's start wrapping it up a minute or two, and then we'll have everybody come back and we'll start doing the readouts from each group. All right, we're going to start coming back to the full group again. And what we're going to do next is each of the groups will do sort of like a 4 or 5 minute readout of, you know, just kind of summarizing their discussion. And, you know, hopefully we'll have a little bit of time left over after that so we can have each group kind of discussing points of the other groups that they weren't in. So I'll give you a minute to kind of resettle back to where you want to go. Are you the reporter, Lloyd? So as we get into these summary discussions, I know, you know, a lot of you had a lot more that you wanted to discuss, and that's great. I mean, we're really happy that, you know, we've got a really good dialogue going here. But these summary discussions, they are being recorded, so we will have somewhat of a record so that, you know, as we get into follow-up in the coming months, you know, we'll have a baseline at least to start with. All right. So we're going to start out with the first report out from the group that was up in this corner, which was professional services, capturing a variety of different topics. I believe, Lloyd, you're doing this? Do you want? Yeah, so we'll each group will do a few minutes. I see they're still frantically working in the back there. But each group will start doing this, and then we'll open it up for larger discussion amongst the, you know, people who want to provide their opinions on what each group has to say.
Rudy, thank you very much. All right, so we had a very small group, so we kind of went through ours fairly quickly. But in terms of the group composition, so we had four folks in our group, and covering the professional services, we had three members from the engineering side, and one from the medical side. Unfortunately, as I said, out of the four that we had, we lost two, so we lost 50%. Then we got one back, which was our token venture capitalist. All right. So, going back to the questions that we had, smart eyewear in the marketplace. What was our top five buying criteria? So there were several that actually came to the market, came to the surface. They range from cost effectiveness as far as from a pricing standpoint, because we looked at it from a from an end user or usability standpoint. So cost effective came up, robustness, something which was also intuitive, convenient, as well as accuracy. So when we looked at those and we kind of went down to one more level and kind of started ranking those, we looked at cost effectiveness being number one. We looked at improved accuracy being number two, robustness being number three, intuitiveness being number four, and convenience being number five. So kind of, you know, when you look at intuitiveness and convenience from an end user standpoint, I may have would have looked at that as kind of convenience being higher, you know, when you looked from an end user standpoint. But again, you know, we had a bunch of engineers, so we really don't care too much about convenience. All right. Number two, top use case, obstacles and challenges. So we had a number of them here as well. We had ranged from traceability, maintenance. When we talked about maintenance, ease of use, ease of maintenance, design insights, perishable. Perishable was an interesting one that came up, and this was brought up to the table from our medical guy. And when he talked about perishableness, he was talking about perishableness of useful data, i.e., in the medical space, the aging of data could be very critical. So if you know, if you've got some information and, you know, 30 seconds data, like, I don't know, heart rate monitor or blood pressure, you know, that kind of data, it's very perishable. It's, you know, 30 seconds, 2 minutes further, it's not useful any longer. So that came up as an important one. Route calibration. was a very interesting one as well, you know, which tended into the accuracy piece. So as far as ranking, design insights came up as number one. Again, very engineering centric. Two, remote calibration. So remote calibration came up as number two, maintenance number three, traceability number four, and perishable information came up as number five. The last and final one, what needs to happen to overcome these hurdles? So again, we had a range of things which came up. These range from better optics. Am I doing this right, Ray? Yeah, we had better optics, improved processing, more lightweight. The glass itself had to be anti-shatterproof or replaceable. Again, this was something else which came up from the medical folks. Improved processing, heat dissipation, and battery location. So look to those from a ranking standpoint. Better optics, number one. More lightweight, number two. Improved processing or expanded field of view, number three. Heat dissipation, number four. And battery location, number five. So those are the ones that came up from our very heavy engineering-centric group. So that's it from reporting from the professional services group, and I'll hand it back to Rudy for one of the other groups.
And we're going to go to the industrial group next.
Thank you. Hey guys, first of all, the professional service and engineering group will really like that the industry thinks in the same way, and I'm just going to repeat whatever he said. Let's start with what are the buying criteria. The buying criteria is again, it goes hand in hand with what are the hurdles that we have. So again, the first and the foremost thing that we thought was the safety and the certification that is needed for all these glasses to be commercialized in an industrial application. On any kind of oil and gas industry or any industry, it needs to have proper certification. And so we have a few products. It's just that not all of them have certified. So if there is no certification, the industry just can't use it. So that's number one. Second is again the return on investment. The price could be very high as long as it gives the proper return on investment. And so the total cost of ownership and everything, just in a broad spectrum, we could say the price and the ROI. So that is a buying criteria. Third. Again, the engineers won't agree, but then the total user experience, because if a management team or the boss and the big people and the people who are putting the money behind it, they need to have a good user experience. This involves the comfort, the battery life, and every other factor, but can be broadly summarized into user experience. Number four. Integration into existing technology. So there is a stable workflow that has been done probably for the last 20 years, 25 years, and now this AR and the VR technology is very new. So how will it be integrated into the existing technology? Will it disrupt it? Will it just add on to the process? So again, we could sub-factor this and we could say about security, about the accuracy of data, how reliable is this workflow, the new workflow. So this is number four. Number five is again, scalability. How easily can it be deployable? The industry is big, we have 1,000 users for the support and the training for these 1,000 users. So scalability is number five. This is a factor that we look into buying these things. So number one is safety, number two is ROI, number three is the total user experience. Number four is integration into existing technology. Number five is scalability. Yeah, and the hurdles. First of all is my handwriting. Big hurdle. Okay. The hurdles is again for the lack of safety, lack of certification. And safety again on a broader aspect would be to involve the optical industry. Right now, the AR industry is focusing more on the technology, but then we have to know and we have to understand that this is still eyewear, so the optics behind it has to be involved. So a better optics and This will again increase the safety of a device. Number two is, again, adaptability to each and everyone. Each and everyone is different. We have different features. We have different focal length of our cornea, and somebody from medical guy, I mean, he could explain. So this has to be more flexible. The variability factor has to increase. So yeah, so this is a big hurdle now. Number three is, again, the infrastructure. We have a proper infrastructure that is already stable. It gives out a proper product. This industry has an infrastructure. So how can it be integrated into it? So this is number three. Number four is lack of focus between the companies that is coming up. So in last 5 years, we have so many companies coming up with different hardware, different software. So it is a very fragmented industry. It is good because we need a high degree of customization for each and every case, but it is still a very fragmented industry. So there is not much consolidation that has happened yet. And we have a solution for that. But then, yeah, so that is the case right now. And there is no other hurdle. So that's it. So number one. So number one is, again, the lack of certification, the EX proof, the safety aspect. Number two is the variability factor. Number three is the total infrastructure factor, like the connectivity issues and the existing technology. And number four is the lack of focus in the market that we have now. The solutions to it. Safety and regulation, I think we are still coming up. People are, we have the DACRI helmet and the Vuzix safety glasses. So I think safety regulations are coming up. It just needs to accelerate better. Variability factor, I don't know. I mean, the eyeglass makers have to come with something. So probably something like with the Oculus Rift, where you can calibrate to each and every user before using it. So that is probably a solution. Again, for the infrastructure, I think with time, it will keep on getting better. And just with time, it will be a part of the existing workflow. We never used tablets 5 years, 10 years before. Now every engineering, every construction process has an iPad or some sort of smartphone integrated into the workflow. Lack of focus and fragmentation. Darwin's theory, survival of the fittest. So all the companies, survival of the fittest. So that was probably a solution. So in due course of time, we'll have a more focused company who are in for the long run. And also, I think the larger companies, like the Apple buying Metaio and everything, these companies need to come in. They need to consolidate different products and give it a proper direction. Yeah, so that's it from the industrial part. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. Let's go to the Military Emergency Services Group next. We have about 15 minutes total or so to go. So.
All right, so this industry This industry is a little different because we can't always rely on networks, we can't always rely on being somewhere convenient or clean or with charging stations and all that. So first thing is performance, for the buying criteria, and really it's a definition of the use case and performance matching that need more than anything. And then fail-safe, the great analogy was if you're viewing a camera through goggles and the camera goes out, you can't instantly become blind. And so fallbacks, the fallback natural vision, alternate network connections, things like that. Value add, there's a lot of neat things you can do, but if it doesn't actually make your work more productive or limit the number of people needed to do the same set of tasks, then there's no reason to do it. And then swap, right? So size, weight, and power, and cost added in as well. Is it something that you would carry at the trade-off of carrying some other hardware in this industry? Maybe it's extra bullets, maybe it's more battery for your other device or something like that. And then interoperability. There's a lot of legacy systems in all of these industries, medical, healthcare infrastructures, defense networks, security, gateways, all that stuff. And so, you know, how it fits into that existing infrastructure is a huge buying criteria. And then on the use cases, one of the key things that sort of seemed to float up in our group is situational awareness, information awareness. When I look around, what's around me? Now, in other markets, that could be where's the nearest bar. In the military, it could be where's the nearest enemy. And then, you know, for an ambulance, it could be which hospital has an open bed for me to go to first instead of waiting 3 hours before I can pick up my next patient because I have to wait with them in a hallway. And then taking the situational awareness and making it collaborative, right? So now I have lots of people with different viewpoints or different contexts or different sensors available. How do we collaborate to make group decisions? How do we, you know, sort of escalate up the echelon to make the person making the decision more informed in a non-distracting, high-value add manner? And then everyone loves this, and in every context, the bionic eye, right? How do I make what I can personally do more powerful, more meaningful, more useful? You know, how do I see through the wall? How do I see the vein that I'm about to put an IV in? You know, how do I take the human experience and make it that much more powerful? And then training and pre-visualization. One of the ways to make the user more powerful is let them practice. A lot of these situations, you have a high-value asset, like a piece of equipment that if you damage, big problem, millions of dollars of downtime. So letting you practice, same with people. You know, you want to practice ahead of time before you have, you know, high collateral consequences. And so pre-visualization, pre-training, you know, letting your mind sort of have the experience ahead of time so you don't have to absorb everything in real time, just the things that are new or different in this scenario. And then instructional and procedural use cases. So maybe it's something I haven't done before, and so I need to be fed a step-by-step. Or maybe I'm doing it now under duress, and I can actively use a camera or some third-party expert to sit there and remind me, yes, I set the right torque setting, or you know, yes, I pointed the right direction when I shot the final shot of the game, right? So it's the, you know, the coaching, the prompts, the aids, so that if I'm maybe not performing my best or I'm doing something I've never done before, I still have the best chance of success. And then challenges. There's a lot of challenges. Try not to overlap the other challenges too much. Battery power, processing power, all that stuff. But some specific challenges here are we really need to know the context that you're working in. If I'm an emergency room physician or if I'm a mechanic, you know, in any of these industries, the context is so important with how much information we can present to you, how much you know, interactivity you're going to have available for the interface. You know, can you touch something, or do you just have to mumble or do head gestures, or whatever? That's all based on context. You know, how much throughput you need versus intrusion. And so, knowing the context and having really good tracking, right? So if I'm just need a compass, or if I just need something that says, hey, you're in the neighborhood, that something else happened, that's one thing. But if I need to say that window 5 days ago, you know, a shot came out, or that street corner, you know, something happened, you have to lock that very precisely. Or if I have a patient and I need to know, you know, have I gotten all of the cancer tissue, right? Well, you don't want to be off by a millimeter, especially in neural surgery. So registering all this useful information to the real world is vitally important and very processor intensive. With current techniques. Likewise, network connectivity, especially in these industries. You could be running around in an ambulance, or you could be running around in the desert thousands of miles away. The bandwidth, as well as even the availability of the network, is vital. And so any fallback procedures, that all comes into the reliability and the fail-safe. The field of view and image quality. Right. If I'm going to do a medical procedure, I need good image quality. If I'm going to read a wiring diagram or you know, a map with any detail, I need to be able to read text. I need to see fine lines, you know, topographic lines, things like that. But at the same time, if I'm going to do any sort of the training use cases, field of view becomes more and more important. If you want an immersive pre-visualization experience, you need immersive field of view. And so there's always a size, weight, and power trade-off, and that's the next item. Size, weight, and power, and cost. For the industry here, because you have high value consequences, high value assets, high value investments that you're trying to protect or utilize, there's slightly different balance in size, weight, and power. But at the same time, someone has to be able to wear it. They have to be able to wear it a long time for their job. Otherwise, you've actually deteriorated their performance in the long run. And so size, weight, power, and cost are very important challenges to overcome. And then adoption, especially in a medical industry or a military context, or you have very entrenched procedures. There's the way that's approved. If you do it differently and you're wrong, you get in a lot of trouble. And so people are very stagnated in how they perform tasks, how they adopt to new technology. There's huge legacy infrastructure investments that you need to overcome for security gateways or network protocols, data formats, all that. So the legacy inertia in how things have been done and how you bridge that gap is a vital challenge in this industry. So.
Is that 4 minutes?
Not long.
All right, thank you very much. So last group that we have coming up is the consumer group. And actually, before Ron starts, because I know we're running a little tight on time, we probably won't get into a dialogue group to group. I'm talking into two mics here. So the one thing that I wanted to bring up that was extremely important, because we'd really like to get your notes. Whoever was a scribe, please provide us your notes. We're going to try to pull all this together into a document that we can share with everyone. Before anybody left with the notes, I just wanted to make sure to put that out there to give it to either your group leader or bring it up to the front. But let me turn it over to Ron. We'll do that summary, and then just a quick wrap-up slide on where we go from here.
Thank you. So consumer group was great. We had a few challenges that we had to overcome. One was the size of the group and trying to reach consensus in the short amount of time that we had. And number two was the vast number of use cases and applications for AR in the consumer area. So we didn't do so much ranking as we did listing. So don't necessarily accept what we've come up with as ranked. But that could follow. So the other thing we did a little bit differently was we went about this in a different direction. So we started by identifying the use cases that we wanted to focus on. And there were six of those. Those were the navigation and guidance, the shopping and commerce, the media TV/photos, special needs assistance, and remote expert, and gaming, of course. So then we went back and we evaluated the buying criteria based on each of those use cases. And for the sake of time, I'm not going to be listing all of those, but it pretty much boiled down to network connectivity, the form factor, that's the weight, the size, the comfort, the ability for multimodal input control, voice, gesture, touch, battery life was certainly one of the big buying criteria, and compatibility with eyeglasses. And then, getting to the solutions for overcoming the hurdles, certainly power supply consumption management was the big thing that needed to be solved. An acceptable form factor, huge, huge hurdle that needs to be overcome, and GPS precision, as well as another very important one, was addressing laws formation of laws that address liability, especially in the navigation space and so forth. There's probably a lot of implications of augmented reality-based injuries that haven't even been thought of or haven't occurred yet and therefore haven't been addressed. And perhaps that needs to be part of this exercise that we're doing in this white paper to address that. So I ran through that very quickly, but I do thank everybody in the group for very valuable input.
All right. Thank you very much. So group discussion, we'll consider that the group discussion since we won't have time to go into it. First, thanks everybody for coming. I think we got a lot of great input. It was a It was interesting trying to pull this together. I wouldn't say it went exactly the way we scoped it out in the planning, but I think we still got a lot of terrific information shared. And now really the next step for us is actually starting to pull this information together, share it with you, and use this as the basis of starting to put together a white paper that's discussing all these issues. So as I mentioned at the start, this is really a beginning of a group. This isn't just a one-time event and summary. So, most importantly, we invite you to join these recurring discussions that we have on this. As I mentioned, we've been doing this for maybe 2 months or so in the planning of it, and getting some good material together that served as a basis for the workshop. But now, we want to expand this core team of 4 or 5 of us who've been working on it. So we certainly invite you to join the team. We will get an email out with all the information written up to everybody whose badge got scanned. But if you want to leave us a business card or other means to make sure that you're on the distribution list for all this information, please just leave it with either the group leads or me up front, whichever works best. So again, our goal is to do a white paper by the end of the year. To do that, besides doing the ongoing discussions, because I know with weekly calls, there's not one great time that works for everybody, and people will be in and out of those. IEEE has actually offered to host another a full-day session, take this 2-hour one, go into a lot more depth sometime in the fall. When that would be, it really depends on how the group progresses on these weekly, bi-weekly calls and where we're at, and we would set the agendas and all that based on how that goes. So right now that would be an aim to do another in-person, trying to get everybody, because it always works so much better when you have everyone face-to-face. And we'll try to keep it somewhat short and sweet if we can tie it to another event or something. We certainly try to make it as time efficient for everyone as possible. So beyond the white paper, we're actually establishing the support for this out of IEEE through a program we have called Industry Connections. And the idea is that's sort of an ad hoc interest group is really what it amounts to, that actually works on issues of common interest. So beyond the white paper, whatever comes out of it, as here's actionable things we can do. I'll admit part of the motivation is to have it as a program that provides us to allows us to provide a bit more support through IEEE and makes it a little bit more formal of a program. I think Ori Inbar will be probably getting involved in this as well. He was sort of the instigator who came to a number of us early on. But again, we really invite you to participate on this on a regular basis. I thought there was a lot of great information that came out. We look forward to further discussions in the coming months. And please give us your contact info if you want to be a part of this. Thank you again, everyone, for coming. Thanks to the core team for all the work they did in putting all this together as well. And apparently we're missing one clicker. So if somebody has a stray clicker, hopefully nobody walked out of the room with it. Oh, is there one back there? Did we find it? All right. Well, we'll try to find it, but make sure you didn't put it in your pockets or bags or anything on your way out. But thank you again all for coming today, and hope you enjoyed.